Harper Audio presents Going Rogue, An American Life, written and read by Sarah Palin. Copyright 2009 by Sarah Palin. Production and abridgment copyright 2009 by HarperCollins Publishers. It was the Alaska State Fair, August 2008, with the gray Talkeetna Mountains in the distance and the first light covering of snow about to descend on Pioneer Peak. I breathed in an autumn bouquet that combined everything small-town America with rugged splashes of the last frontier. Cotton candy and foot-long hot dogs, halibut tacos and reindeer sausage, banjo music playing at the Blue Bonnet stage, baleen etchings, grass-woven Eskimo baskets, and record-breaking giant vegetables grown under the midnight sun. Inching through rivers of people with Trig, our four-month-old son, cradled in my arms, I zigzagged from booth to booth, from driftwood art to honeybee keeping to home-brewed salmonberry wine. Bristol and Willow, our teenage daughters, roamed ahead with friends, heads together, laughing, thumbs tapping cell phones. Piper, 7, my constant sidekick since the moment she was born, bounced along at my hip, pinching off fluffs of cotton candy, her reward for patiently accommodating my stop-and-go progress through the crowd. For the most part, she was comfortable watching the grip-and-grin photos and hearing the friendly chit-chat with constituents that I enjoyed as part of my job as governor of the state. Every few moments, I pulled my right arm free from baby duty to shake hands with folks who wanted to say hello. Hey, Sarah, you never miss the fair. Oh, my goodness, is that the new little one? Let me say hi to him. Price of energy's pretty high, Governor. When are they going to ramp up drilling? A robin's egg sky arched overhead, the brisk kick in the air hinting at winter's approach. Like a family conga line, we wound our way among the vendors and exhibits, from pork chops on a stick to kettle corn, veggie weigh-ins, and livestock competitions. A local dance troupe took to the stage and the music blared, competing with the constant hum of generators and squealing kids on rides. Ahead, on my right, I saw the Alaska Right to Life booth, where a poster caught my eye, taking my breath away. It featured the sweetest baby girl swathed in pink, pretend angel wings fastened to her soft shoulders. "That's you, baby," I whispered to Piper, as I have every year since she smiled for the picture as an infant. She popped another cloud of cotton candy into her mouth and looked nonchalant. Still the pro-life poster child at the state fair. Ho-hum. Well, I still thought it was a nice shot, as I did every time I saw it on its advertisements and fundraiser tickets. It reminded me of the preciousness of life. It also reminded me of how impatient I am with politics. A staunch advocate of every child's right to be born, I was pro-life enough for the grassroots Alaska Right to Life folks to adopt Piper as their poster child, but I wasn't politically connected enough for the state GOP machine to allow the organization to endorse me in early campaigns. From inside the booth, a very nice volunteer caught my glance, so I tucked my head inside, shook hands, and thanked the gracious ladies who put up with the jeers of those who always protested the display. With their passion and sincerity, the ladies typified the difference between principles and politics. As I signed the visitor's book, I saw Piper's picture again on the counter and became annoyed at my own annoyance. I still hadn't learned to accept the fact that political machines twist and distort public service and that a lot of times, very little they do makes any sense. Years before, I had seen our state speeding toward an economic train wreck. Since construction began in 1975 on what would become Alaska's economic lifeline, the Trans-Alaska Pipeline, it had grown increasingly obvious to everyday Alaskans that many of their public servants were not necessarily serving the public. Instead, they had climbed into bed with big oil. Meanwhile, in a young state whose people clung to America's original pioneering and independent spirit, government was growing as fast as fireweed in July. It didn't make sense. It seemed that true public service, crafting policies that were good for the people, had become increasingly derailed by politics and its infernal machines. but I had a drive to help, an interest in government and current events since I was a little kid, and I had become aware of the impact of common sense public policy during the presidency of Ronald Reagan. I was intrigued by political science in college and studied journalism because of my passion for the power of words, and I had been raised to believe that in America, anyone can make a difference. So I got involved. I served first on the Wasilla City Council, then two terms as mayor, helping turn our sleepy little town into the fastest-growing community in the state. Then I served as an oil and gas regulator, overseeing the energy industry and encouraging responsible resource development, Alaska's main economic lifeline. In 2002, as my second mayoral term wound down, my husband Todd and I began to consider my next step. With four busy kids, I would certainly have enough going on to keep me occupied, even if I chose to put public service aside. And for a while, I did. But I still felt a restlessness, an insistent tugging on my heart that told me there were additional areas where I could contribute. From what I could see from my position in the center of the state, the capital of Juneau seemed stocked mainly with good old boys who lunched with oil company executives and cut fat cat deals behind closed doors. Like most Alaskans, I could see that the votes of many lawmakers lined up conveniently with what was best for big oil, sometimes to the detriment of their own constituents. When oil began flowing from Prudhoe Bay in 1977, billions of dollars flowed into state coffers with it. The state raked in more revenue than anyone could have imagined. Billions of dollars almost overnight. And the politicians spent it. Government grew rapidly. One quarter of our workforce was employed by state and local governments, and even more was tied to the state budget through contracts and subsidies. Everyone knew there was a certain amount of back-scratching going on, but an economic crash in the 1980s collapsed the oil boom. Businesses closed and unemployment soared. During the oil boom, anyone who questioned the government's giving more power to the oil companies was condemned. What are you trying to do? Slay the golden goose? But when the boom went bust, the golden goose still ruled the roost. By then, state government was essentially surrendering its ability to act in the best interests of the people. So I ran for governor. I didn't necessarily get into government to become an ethics crusader, but it seemed that every level of government I encountered was paralyzed by the same politics-as-usual system. I wasn't wired to play that game. And because I fought political corruption regardless of party, GOP leaders distanced themselves from me and eventually my administration, which really was fine with me. Though I was a registered Republican, I had always been without a political home, and now, even as governor, I was still outside the favored GOP circle. I considered that a mutually beneficial relationship. Politically, I didn't owe anyone, and nobody owed me. That gave me the freedom and latitude to find the best people to serve Alaskans, regardless of party, and I was beholden only to those who hired me, the people of Alaska. Still in the Alaska Right to Life booth, Piper said she was ready to go. She was antsy to stop by the fair's hula hoop contest, so I hurriedly shook a couple more hands and gathered Trig back from the nice lady who had asked to hold him. I had certainly gotten off on the wrong foot with the Republican Party by daring to take on the GOP chairman, Randy Redrick, and then incumbent governor, Frank Murkowski. Party bosses weren't going to let me forget that I had broken their 11th commandment, "Thou shalt not speak ill of a fellow Republican." Even if Murkowski did have a 19% approval rating, his chief of staff would later plead guilty to a felony charge, and it appeared corruption was growing at a breakneck pace. I didn't have time to waste embracing the status quo and never had it in me to play the party's game. That just meant I'd have to work harder, advancing the state not on the currency of traded favors, but on the strength of ideas that prove themselves good for the people. This was the only way I'd found to transform a grudging bureaucracy into a team that could try to reform government and shrink its reach into our lives. Since being elected governor in 2006, I had managed to rack up an 88% approval rating, and though I didn't put much stock in fickle polls, I figured my administration must be doing something right. To me, it signaled that Alaskans, with their independent spirit, wanted principle-centered policies, not the same old politics as usual. I was grateful. All I wanted was a chance to work as hard as I could, serve the people honorably, and I figured that maybe between changing state government and changing diapers, we'd help change our corner of the world. In the Right to Life booth, I smiled, dropped some dollars into the contribution can, and didn't care who might be watching, including local reporters. Alaskans knew my pro-life views, no news there. At that moment, one of my Blackberries vibrated me back to work. I was thankful for the excuse to hustle back into the sunshine. Piper tugged on my arm with sticky fingers, whispering reminders that I'd promised if she was patient, I'd take her on a roller coaster ride too. Just this one last call, baby, I told her. I ducked behind the booth, hoping it was my son Track calling from his army base at Fort Wainwright. He was set to deploy to Iraq soon, and his sporadic calls were something I lived for. But in case it wasn't Track, I offered up a silent fallback prayer. Please, Lord, just for an hour, anything but politics. I punched the green phone icon and answered, hopefully, "This is Sarah." It was Senator John McCain asking if I wanted to help him change history. From Sandpoint, Idaho, where I was born, via Juneau, Alaska, I touched down in the windy, remote frontier town of Skagway, cradled in my mother's arms. I was just 3 months old, and barely 60 days had passed since the largest earthquake on record in North American history struck Alaska on Good Friday, March 27, 1964. The quake altered the topography of Alaska forever. Mother Nature showed her might and reminded us that she always wins. But that didn't scare my parents, Chuck and Sally Heath, who weren't about to change their minds about pulling up stakes in Idaho, where my dad was a school teacher, and settling in America's untamed north. Instead, my parents thought the Good Friday earthquake, with a 9.2 magnitude, the second largest ever recorded, added to the aura of rugged adventure that lured them to the 49th state, which was then only 5 years old. My big brother, Chuck Jr., was two at the time, and my sister Heather was one, so they were old enough to sit up by themselves in the Grumman Goose we flew in on, a 1930s-era plane that looked like it came straight out of the movie Casablanca. By the time the Heath family arrived, the population of Skagway was only about 650, way down from its heyday in the summer of 1897, when the town boomed with thousands of fortune hunters who streamed in with the Klondike Gold Rush. Skagway was a sweet start in life. Mom and Dad rented a tiny wooden house built in 1898 on the corner of First and Main. Alaska's wealthiest banking family, the Rasmussens, owned it. 30 months after we landed in town, my younger sister Molly was born. We added a couple of dogs and a cat, and the Heath family was complete. Perched on the rim of a harbor at the northern apex of the Inside Passage, Skagway is encircled by mountains. I remember the air smelled of ocean salt, and that even though the town was small, it bustled with boats in port, locomotives churning through to Canada, and the hum of propellers on the gravel airstrip right near the middle of town. I remember lush emerald moss hugging the hillsides. Mom always said she was going to buy a carpet that color someday, and one day she did. The southeast Alaska winters are brutal. In Skagway, icy winds tear relentlessly through town. But I don't remember the winters as well. I mostly remember sunny summer days. Playing dress-up with my sisters under a wild crabapple tree. I remember community basketball games. And I remember arguing with the nun who taught catechism and tried to teach me to write the letter E. It seemed a naked letter to me, so I was determined to reinvent it. I insisted she let me improve it with at least a few more horizontal lines. I shared a little bedroom with my sisters while my brother, Chuck, slept in a closet, which also doubled as a sewing room. Chuck was all boy. Once he pulled the town fire alarm. The fire chief visited our home, and Dad's hand visited Chuck's backside. Another time, he pulled a burning catalog Dad used as kindling out of our rock fireplace, dropped it on the living room floor in a panic, and nearly burned Mr. Rasmussen's house down. My sisters and I loved our big brother, and we loved each other, but still, we all scrapped like Wolverines. Mom had agreed to give Alaska a one-year trial run, but our short stint in the quaint old tourist town, inaccessible by roads, turned into 5 years of Dad teaching and coaching, working summers on the Alaska Railroad, and tending bar in seasonal...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.